Well, hello, everybody. My name is Jason DaCosta. Thank you for joining me today on my show called Consistent Preterism. Every so often, I like to start out this show with a very, very hard, heavy metal type of music. And I like to do that because I know that it just explodes people's heads, because you know the whole stereotypical thing about heavy metal and how it's tied to the devil, who was, you know, basically old covenant Jews. So I like to do that because I know that when people come over here and listen, that probably instantly gets them on edge. And it just makes me chuckle a little bit thinking about traditionalist fundamental Christians listening to my audio, giving it a listen, and being immediately presented with this so-called devilish music, which is good music. I mean, it's not, you know, it has nothing to do with the devil or any demons or anything like that. It's just, hey, it's good music. It gets you pumped up. But yeah, so anyways, today's audio is called Does Fullness Really Mean Fullness? And obviously you all know it's comes from Romans 11, the fullness, when the fullness of the Gentiles comes in, all Israel will be saved, or when the fullness of the ones in the nations comes in, all Israel will be saved, or in this way all Israel will be saved, said Paul. And Paul concludes that at the coming of Jacob's Redeemer, which we know was in was that the coming of the Lord. So I wanted to just kind of address this quickly, because it seems like the inconsistent full preterist is doing any and everything that they can do to get around this most obvious point, okay? And it's really embarrassing, to be honest, some of the things that people will say to try to avoid the obvious. It's almost reminding me of like the futurist when you present them with Matthew 16, 27 and 28, where Jesus says, truly I say to you, there are some standing here who will not taste death till they see the Son of Man coming in his kingdom. And these futurists, they know they're stuck. They know that they have to do something with that. So they say it's the transfiguration, which occurred 6 days later. So what they say is that Jesus was speaking of 6 days later when he made that most amazing prediction that some of them standing there would be alive when he transfigured 6 days later. Man, what a prophet. But obviously we all know, we shake our heads, we laugh. It's just nonsense, right? They're just doing anything and everything they can to get around what's so very clear. Obviously, we know that 40 years, roughly give or take, is a much more reasonable explanation to that statement made by Jesus. And that's exactly when he did come to take his bride and to end the age. So this whole fullness thing in Romans 11 has really been a thorn in the side of the inconsistent full preterist. And what they like to say is they like to say that it means that the word fullness there does not have anything to do with an amount or a number or a full completion of Gentiles, but rather it has to do with equality or equal status. And it's so stupid if you really think about it. But we're going to kind of look at that a little bit today and see where it comes from. I'm going to read you a couple quotes from the great Don K. Preston and see how he tries to dance around this like Donny Osmond. And we're going to read what the word actually means. We're going to look at some examples of it in the scriptures. And hopefully by the end of this, we'll see that they have no shot. All right. The first thing, before we do any of that, I want to sort of back this up to show you that this passage alone in Romans 11, when understood as a number or a fullness or a completion of the Gentiles, does not stand alone. Let me repeat, this passage, the fullness of the Gentiles coming in by the coming of the Redeemer, does not stand on its own. In other words, we're not just taking that passage and building a doctrine off of one passage. That passage is exact and matches exact to many other passages in the New Testament. One of them, which you all know, is Matthew 24, verse 14, where Jesus says to them in the Olivet Discourse that this gospel will go to, quote, all nations, and then the end will come. Well, you guessed it. The same word there used for Gentiles in Romans 11 is used for nations in Matthew 24. It's ethnos. All right. So what Christ is saying essentially is that this gospel will go to all the people or all the nations or all the Gentiles, and then the end will come. Well, as a full preterist, you have to admit when that end was. Okay, you can't push this out to a future end. It just won't work. So the only end that Jesus speaks of, he shows us and encapsulates it in verse 34 of that same chapter and says, all these things will happen in this generation. He, like I told you in Matthew 16, he ensures his coming would take place before some of them standing there died. He tells them elsewhere, I think it's Matthew 10, that they wouldn't even finish preaching through the towns of Israel before he came. Of course, we have all these usages of the Greek word mello every time we speak of the resurrection in the New Testament, which literally means about to be. There was about to be a resurrection of the just and unjust, said Paul. We have all these statements from James, the judge is at the door. In Hebrews, he will not delay, he will not tarry. In Revelation 20-something times, we have the statement from John, all these things are at hand, they will soon come to pass, they will shortly take place. Behold, I am coming quickly. So we have just a barrage of evidence in the New Testament that all of this was going to take place exactly when Jesus said it would. There was no trickery, there was no imaginary meaning to words like soon, none of that. They were communicating to real living people using real understandable words that they would understand. And in no planet, I don't care if you're an alien way out in the third galaxy, the word soon does not mean 2,000 years. I'm sorry, it just doesn't. So anyways, we have to understand that Romans 11, the fullness of the Gentiles, matches what Jesus said in Matthew 24:14, that the gospel would go to all nations, or all Gentiles, you could say, because it's the same word, and then the end would come. So clearly, Jesus and Paul are agreeing with one another in under my paradigm. But Don Preston says that Paul in Romans 11 is not talking about a literal completion of Gentiles coming in, but rather he's talking about the Gentiles obtaining an equal status as the Israelites. And so how Don would read that is that when the Gentiles reach their equal status, all Israel will be saved. It just makes no sense. It's stupid on every level, okay? Every level. And what he would also have to then agree with is in Matthew 24:14 that Jesus was also talking about some wacky equality concept. So I guess Jesus, when he said all nations would get the gospel and then the end would come, really was just talking about, I don't know, somehow all nations would get equality status and then the end would come. I don't know. It just makes no sense. So we see already that Jesus in Matthew 24:14 corroborates what Paul says in Romans 11, that the end would come. And by that time of that end, all the Gentiles who needed salvation would be in. They would have had it. They would receive it and they would have received the gospel and then the end would come. So there was no gospel after the end. It was for a specific purpose to gather in the lost sheep wherever they were, out in the nations, in Samaria, in Judea, in Jerusalem, didn't matter. That was the mission and it was very direct. The other places we can corroborate are places such as Revelation chapter 7. In Revelation chapter 7, we see that the great multitude from all nations, right, was redeemed, standing clothed, having inherited their promise. Now, interestingly enough, in the first half of Revelation 7, John listens and hears the number of the children of Israel. That's the elect. He hears the number. He says 144,000 of all the tribes of the children of Israel were sealed. Well, that was the mission, wasn't it? To go out and seal the elect on their foreheads. There's only one mission here. There's only one people in focus in that mission. That's the elect. So when John sees or hears the elect in the beginning of Revelation chapter 7 and says he heard the number of those who were sealed, John is basically telling you that all the ones that were sealed were the 12 tribes of Israel. Because then he goes on, he says, and this is the number of those who were sealed, 144,000 of all the tribes of the children of Israel. Then he looks, okay, and he sees, he doesn't hear anymore, but he actually sees this great multitude. And what does he say? He says, I saw them and they were from all nations, tongues, tribes, and kindreds. And why is that? Well, because the gospel was going to all those nations to gather them in. So you have Greeks, you have Italians, you have all these people coming in from these surrounding nations, but they're all of the 12 tribes of Israel. They're descendants of the tribes. So they're gathered back in. And guess what? That picture in Revelation 7 of all the ones from the nations standing fully redeemed, fully saved, fully inheriting their promise and standing before the throne clothed in white saying salvation belongs to our God, praising him and singing a new song, which by the way pulls from Israel's Old Testament history as well. That picture was complete And guess what? That picture was at hand and about to take place when John wrote. Just another proof that Romans 11, where Paul says the fullness of the ones in the nations would come in and all Israel would be saved, correlates with Revelation 7 that was at hand. And that means that that completed picture of all the elect standing before God being redeemed took place. That is not in our future. Like I said, it's futurism or bust here, big boy. So they can either go back to futurism and say that that picture is in the future and take words like soon and at hand to mean 2,000 years, or they can be honest and say, you know what, that is a completed picture of salvation from all the ones in the nations. So that does kind of prove that what Paul is saying in Romans 11 is really a fullness of or a completion of the ones in the nations. And then the last place I'm going to show you just to corroborate this once more is John 6, where Jesus says, all the ones whom God has given me, I will lose none, and I will raise them up on the last day. I will lose none. They will all be raised up on the last day. That's the same last day that he encapsulates in this generation in Matthew 24. Okay? And so all the elect were raised on the last day. And yes, that includes the ones in the nations. When Peter wrote to them in his epistle, he lists all the nations, Galatia, Cappadocia, Asia Minor, and he calls them elect according to the foreknowledge of God. These were the elect out in the nations, right? And sure, there were Jew and Gentile. There were law-observing ones and there were non-law-observing ones, but they were all Abraham's seed collectively. And there was no distinction between them, okay? Because if they were Christ, they were an heir according to promise. But again, those are the four main passages that I like to go to. There are many more, by the way, for those of you who have followed along. But you know I hammer those four home because they all link like a perfect puzzle. All right, and they all show that there was a full number of elect ones that were going to be raised on the last day, delivered back to the Father as a kingdom, and Christ would lose none. They would all be raised on the last day. And then that perfect picture of all the elect from all the nations where they were gathered from, standing redeemed and fully saved, having inherited their promise, in Revelation 7 really puts the icing on the cake. So already Don's argument of a stupid equality concept in the word fullness in Romans 11:25 is defeated. It doesn't make any sense because in order to hold that, one would have to demonstrate on the other portions that I just showed you how an equality concept works. How does an equality concept fit in with Jesus saying all of my elect will be raised on the last day and I will not lose none? I will lose none. How does that work? It doesn't, right? It's stupid. It's forced. It's a lot like futurist dancing techniques. But I want to read to you a couple things that that were said by Don on Facebook and were sent to me. And we're going to see just how wrong and flawed his understanding of this is. And let me remind you, this is purposely, folks. This is not Don ignorant. Don is a bright man. This is Don purposely rejecting the true definition and true interpretation of this Greek word. So he says this, the fundamental error is in the assumption that the fullness of the Gentiles is numerically focused. The word pleroma does not inherently or even necessarily indicate number. In the context of Romans 11, fullness indicates status and standing, not number. See verse 15, he says. It was Paul's personal responsibility and mission to bring the Gentiles into a full equality with Israel in the one body of Christ. It was not his mission to bring in a given number of Gentiles. Equality of standing in the one body is the focus. Thus, the fundamental premise of your IO is false. He was saying that to somebody. So first of all, Donnie's way off, all right? So let's take a quick look at what this Greek word pleroma, G4138, actually means, okay? Here's its definitions, folks. I kid you not. First definition, that which has been filled. Then it has examples of that. Ready for this one? His first example is a ship as it is filled with sailors, rowers, and soldiers. In the New Testament, the body of believers as that which is filled with the presence power of God. So even right there, he's got no arguments because the main and first definition of this word pleroma is filled, literally filled. Okay, it has nothing to do with equality, nothing at all. All right, it's a completion, it's filled. All right, and the example it gives is a ship filled with sailors. All right. The second one is that which fills or with which a thing is filled. Still talking about filling something up. Then it says of those things which a ship is filled, freight and merchandise, sailors, oarsmen, soldiers. Still talking about a ship being filled up with things. And then it gives another one, completeness, okay, fullness, abundance, a fulfilling. So Donnie's got no argument here. There is not one thing in here which says equality or standing. It's his own made-up interpretation, because what he's doing is he's taking some passages, a couple passages that use the word pleroma in sort of a sense where it's saying, you know, when they reach the fullness of the stature of Christ, for example. But still, that still implies completion. He's not understanding that. Okay, that word fullness, pleroma, used in those few instances that he's basing his entire argument on, still implies completion. Because when they reach that fullness, that full stature, it would be complete. All right, they would fulfill coming to that full stature of Christ. All right, so he's really going out on a limb here and trying to dance around the obvious. The Strong's definition of the word says this: completion, what fills, as in contents, supplements, multitude, or objectively, what is filled, as in container, performance, period, which is put in to fill up, piece that is filled up, fulfilling full fullness. There's nothing in there like Don is saying, okay? So again, this whole misunderstanding or purposely being misunderstood by Don is because he understands the implications of taking this word as it truly is, you know, fullness, clear as day. Okay, it makes no sense for Paul to say, when the Gentiles reach equality with Israel, all Israel will be saved. Doesn't make any sense. That's absolutely asinine to suggest. But yet Don acts as if this is a logical, intelligent approach. And it's quite disturbing. All right, so I just showed you the true definition of it. Let's read another one of Donnie's quotes. Oh, actually, you know what? Before we do that, I want to address something that he said. He says this: it was not Paul's mission to bring in a given number of Gentiles. Equality of standing in the one body is his focus. All right, now, is that true? Well, let's break this down logically and think about this critically, okay? When Paul wrote this letter to the Romans, we can probably say that he had been in ministry or had been preaching the gospel to the nations or to wherever he was for a good amount of years, right? I mean, at the very minimum, I think we'd all agree he was probably preaching for at least 5 to 10 years, right? At the very minimum, we'd all agree that Cornelius, who these people would say was a true Gentile, even though Acts 10 specifically states he was a child of Israel when Peter's preaching to his household, but that's another story. They would say that this is a true Gentile. So by the time Paul wrote this letter to the Romans, was Cornelius already considered in equal standing with the others? Of course he was, right? Let's go back and read Don's statement. He says, it was not Paul's mission to bring in a given number of Gentiles, but equality of standing in the one body is his focus. So he's saying that Paul's mission was to get the Gentiles to an equality of standing. But yet Paul is writing this letter long after these so-called Gentiles were already considered equal in standing. Does that make sense? I hope it does. Cornelius, the Philippian jailer, all these things took place before Paul's writing to the Romans. Okay, surely no one's going to argue that Paul wrote to the Romans before Cornelius received the Holy Spirit. Of course not. That would be stupid. So what is Don even trying to say here? Because on the one hand, he's saying it's not about number, but then he's saying that equality of standing was Paul's entire mission. So when did that come to its fulfillment, right? I mean, what is he talking about here? Because the Gentiles, for the most part, those who had already heard the gospel, these Israelites out in the nations, they had already been, according to everything the Bible says, they were already considered equal to the Israelites, right? To the so-called Israelites. And again, I know it's kind of tricky because I'm explaining this in such a way as if I'm an inconsistent full preterist thinking that these are actually true Gentiles. But my point is that Cornelius, for example, was already considered equal in standing to the so-called supposed Israelites, right? So what is Don saying, right? Paul's mission was to make them equal in standing, but yet it doesn't make sense that way because they were already equal in standing. So clearly this is a fullness in terms of a number. This was a full amount of elect that were being gathered in from the nations. And then when all of them came in, every last one of them, in that way, all Israel would be saved. And it would be at that time when the deliverer would come out of Zion and turn away ungodliness from Jacob. And this would be his covenant with Jacob when he took away their sins. So the elect Gentiles were part of Jacob. And this is what Paul says in Acts 13, where he says, as many Gentiles that were appointed to eternal life believed. They didn't believe unless they were appointed to believe. And that's the elect. Right? Here's another quote from Donnie Boy when speaking to someone about I.O. You really should read the definition more carefully before you post. Oh, well, I just read you the entire definition, and it's all about completion, filling up a ship, that which has been filled. It really says absolutely nothing. I don't know if he thinks people just won't look into this stuff or what, but he says, show us where it says that pleroma inherently means a number. Well, I just showed you it means completion. It means that which is filled. It means a ship that is filled up with sailors. It means an object that is filled with something. So if in terms of the gospel going out to the nations, it was the full body of those in the nations being filled up completely. God had an elect amount of ones in the nations, and he knew where they were. Did he not say, my sheep hear my voice and they come? Of course he knew where they were. So he goes, show us where it says that pleroma inherently means a number. Can't do it. Not only that, I show from the context that Paul used pleroma to speak of standing, not of number, in Romans 11:15. So it is you and those like you who are willing to destroy the meaning of fullness and impose on it something that is not in the context. I noticed that, as usual, you totally ignored my comments on Paul's mission to fulfill, that is from pleroma, by the way, the mystery of God. The mystery of God was Jew and Gentile equality, not number. I have not been caught in error. Thou art the man. Like I said, your entire false system falls apart on this single issue, not to mention a multitude of others. And then he tags like 10 people for backup. So what does he do here again? He lies and says, you can't show us that pleroma means a number. Well, I can't show you that the text actually says it means an exact number. But when I say to you that the fullness of my family came over, I'm clearly telling you that all the ones that I were expecting from my family came over. All right, I'm not telling you that my family finally gained equal status with me. No, I'm saying that the fullness of the ones I invited came over. They all came. Okay, and then he goes, not only that, blah blah blah. He says, hold on, you who are willing to destroy the meaning of fullness and impose on it something that is not in the context. I don't know about you folks, but have you ever looked at the word fullness and thought equality? I have never once in my entire 35 years of life ever thought that. So it's quite unnatural. And then he goes, I have not been caught in error. Like I said, your entire system falls apart on this issue, not to mention a multitude of others. And then he said also, you've ignored my comments on Paul's mission to fulfill the mystery of God. Well, what is fulfill? He says the word fulfill is from the word pleroma, like he's proving a point here. But that actually proves him wrong. Because if Paul was on a mission to fulfill the mystery of God, that means Paul was on a mission to complete the mystery of God, right? It doesn't mean that Paul was on a mission to equality the mystery of God, like he says. It means that Paul was on a mission to complete, to fulfill, to fill up, to finalize, okay, the mystery of God. So he's way off on this, way off. And then I'll read his last quote. He says, so the blessing of Christ has nothing to do with the fullness of blessings, but the number of them? Good grief. All you have done is to show that pleroma is not focused on number, as you insist. And you have not touched Romans 11:15, and you have not touched Paul and the completion of the mystery. And then he uses pleroma. But what's amazing is he says, you have not touched Paul and the completion, pleroma, of the mystery. So is he admitting that pleroma actually means completion? It seems like he just did. And if he does that, then he admits that Paul in Romans 11 is talking about the completion of the Gentiles coming in. I don't know what's going on with this guy. Maybe he's losing his marbles a little bit. But he keeps quoting Romans 11:15. Let's read it. It says, "For if their being cast away is the reconciling of the world, what will their acceptance be but life from the dead?" And I'm not exactly sure what word there is, pleroma. Let's go look at it. Hold on. I'm going to pull it up here really quickly. Bear with me because I want to see what he's talking about here. Romans 11:15. There's actually nothing there that is pleroma. Interesting. Oh, I think what he's doing is he is, hold on, let's see. He might be using the word proslemsis. I don't know. I really don't know what he's doing in quoting Romans 11:15. Probably the word isn't used there, but maybe he's saying that this has some sort of implication on the Romans 11:25 portion. But really, it doesn't. It has nothing to do with it. Paul is clearly saying that there was a fullness of ones in the nations that would come in, and in that way, all Israel would be saved. So then he just goes on and he says, argumentum and desperatum, my own personal Latin term. That is not real Latin, but it well describes the desperation of you guys' arguments. I gotta run. I have an old Mustang in a body shop that I have to check on. So, yeah, that's kind of comical. But you can see that he's got no arguments, right? He's telling you that the word pleroma and fullness does not mean completion, yet he even says it means completion right there in his quote. And I've showed you every definition in the Strong's and in the LX, in the Septuagint that shows exactly what this word means. Okay, it means completion, it means fullness, it means filled up, it means that which is filled or that which fills up. It has nothing to do with equality, nothing at all. Okay, and here's just a few examples of this word used in the Bible, and you tell me if it means what Donnie Boy is claiming. Mark 6:43 says, "And they took up 12 baskets full of fragments and of fish." Full, pleroma. They took up 12 baskets full of fragments of the fish. Does that mean they took up 12 baskets of equality of fragments and of fish? No, it means that they took up 12 baskets that were full to the top of fish, with fish. Same thing in Mark 8:20. "Also, when I broke the 7 for the 4,000, how many large baskets full of fragments did you take up?" Pleroma. You can see it means fullness. The basket was full. Romans 13:10, "Love does no harm to a neighbor, therefore love is the fulfillment of the law." Again, what does that have to do with equality? Does that mean love is the equality of the law? No, love fulfills the law. Love completes the law, okay? The law is completed in love. Romans 15:29, "But I know that when I come to you, I shall come in the fullness of the blessing of the gospel of Christ." So what does that mean? Does that mean he'll come in the equality of the blessing of the gospel of Christ? No, it means he will come in the fullness or in the completion of the gospel of Christ. And then it says, "For the earth is the Lord's and all its fullness." 1 Corinthians 10:26. Does that mean the earth is the Lord's and all its equality? No, it means the earth is the Lord's and all of it, completely. All, every bit of it. All right, Galatians 4:4, "But when the fullness of the time had come, God sent forth his son, born of a woman, born under the law, to redeem those under the law." Does that mean that when the equality of the time has come, God sent forth his son, born of a woman? No, it means when the fullness of time, when the completed designated time came, God sent forth his son. In Ephesians 3:19, "To know the love of Christ, which passes knowledge, that you may be filled with all the fullness of God." Does that mean that you're equal with God? No, that means that you are filled with the fullness of God. Fullness, okay? Doesn't mean equality. "For in him dwells all the fullness of the Godhead bodily," speaking of Christ. Again, "For in him dwells all the equality of the Godhead bodily." Well, maybe. That one you might be able to get away with, but I doubt it. It's more, he is the full, complete picture of God bodily. So even in the couple passages that Don might quote to sort of try to prove his wacky, laughable point here, it still means completion. It still means complete. It still means full. It still means fullness. It has absolutely nothing to do with equality. And if you just think about it, what Paul says here, in Romans 11, verse 25. He says, for I do not desire, brethren, that you should be ignorant of this mystery, lest you should be wise in your own opinion, that blindness in part has happened to Israel until the fullness of the Gentiles has come in. So if that means equality or standing, how does that even work? All right, let's think about it. Blindness in part has happened to Israel until the equality of the Gentiles has come in, until the standing of the Gentiles has come in, and so all Israel will be saved? Nah, that makes no sense. You see, the result of those Gentiles coming in was all Israel being saved. It says, in this way, all Israel will be saved. In what way? By the Gentiles coming in. So all Israel being saved, even Donnie Boy knows that all Israel was saved by the end. He'll admit that, as far as I know, unless he's changed his doctrine on that now too, seeing any problems with it. Maybe he did, but as far as I know, he knows that the Israelites or the Jews or whatever he calls them were all saved by the coming of the Lord. But that goes to show you that if that's the case, then all the Gentiles were also saved, because you can't have all Israel saved unless you have the full, complete fullness of the ones in the nations, aka of the Gentiles, coming into that body. You can't. It just doesn't work without it. So I think I've made my point here. There is absolutely no logical, intelligent way that anyone could get to the point of saying that this means equality. Right? When the fullness of when the Gentiles reached equality? Okay, well, when was that going to be? Because when Paul wrote this letter, clearly, so-called Gentiles were already equal with so-called Israelites, according to Preston himself. So what is he trying to say? Was he saying that that Cornelius, being a converted so-called Gentile, was not equal in status yet to the Israelites? Seems as though that's what he would have to say here, if he's saying that Paul is saying that the fullness or the equality of the Gentiles hasn't come in yet here in Romans 11, right? I mean, that just doesn't make sense, because there was no distinction between them. Whether they were Jew, Greek, it didn't matter. If they were Abraham's seed, they were an heir according to promise. So anyways, I think I'll leave that alone. I think I explained that well enough. Again, in the beginning where I correlated it to the other passages, it's really just a knockout punch. They have nothing. They have to wiggle around this and try anything they can. But I just read to you the true definition, which literally says nothing about equality and standing, and everything about being complete, being complete, being full, being filled up, being fulfilled. And that means completion. Therefore, the fullness of the Gentiles means the completion of the Gentiles. When all the Gentiles were completely brought in that needed to be brought in that way, all Israel would be saved. The deliverer would come out of Zion, turn away ungodliness, and take them back to Papa God. As Paul says in 1 Corinthians 15, the kingdom would be delivered to God. So that's all I got for today, folks. Hope you have a wonderful day. I'll be back another place, another time, another day, and another rhyme. Take care, everybody. Bye-bye.